our message for today, I'm going to ask that you take your Bible and turn to the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 19. Very familiar passage of scripture that many of you have read or heard so many times before, but I want to preach from that for today, or kind of teach from it. And Matthew chapter 19, I hope you get your Bible. And I'm going to read one verse, but I'll invite you to read starting at chapter or verse number 16 on down through the rest of the chapter, and that'll make up the context of what I'm going to talk about for the next few minutes. But I'm just going to read verse number 16 for the sake of time. And verse number 16 of Matthew chapter 19, and it simply says, "Just then a man came up to Jesus and asked, 'Teacher, what good thing must I do to inherit eternal life?'" Man comes up to Jesus and he says, "Teacher, what good thing must I do to inherit eternal life?" You know, not too long ago, I was hungry one afternoon and I went to one of my favorite restaurants. And as many of you know, I have an affinity for tacos. I love a good taco, and I've shared that with you all so many times before. But I went to this restaurant and I ordered my tacos, and I drove out there and drove back, and I set up everything at the house. I began to open up, sat down in my easy chair, and began to open up my tacos. And as I opened up the tacos, I could smell that fresh taco smell coming up out of there. And I opened it up and I looked at them before I got ready to eat them, and the meat was there, and the cheese was there, and it was layered. Everything was layered really nice. And so I got my sour cream, put a little sour cream on there, and I began to go in to enjoy my tacos. But just as I took my first bite of my taco, immediately after that first bite, I knew that something was wrong. Something was missing from my taco. And so I looked and I did a double check. I said, "Okay, well, the meat is there and cheese is there. Put my sour cream on there. Lettuce is on there. Everything, you know, checked out. Everything looked good." But the problem was, there's a special cilantro sauce that they normally put on my taco. And guess what? The special sauce was missing. Everything else was just right. The chorizo was good. The cheese, everything was just right. But the problem was, the special sauce was missing. And brothers and sisters, I just believe that somebody watching me right now, your life is kind of like that taco. You know, you're blessed, and you know, you highly favored, and you know that you are. But when you really take a good look at your life, you know that everything is good, but something is missing. The special sauce of life is missing. You look good on the outside. You smell good on the outside. You have it all together, but you're missing the special sauce. In the book of Ecclesiastes, the Bible says that Solomon says in the book of Ecclesiastes that you and I were made for eternity. He says that eternity has been placed in the human heart. And what Solomon was saying is that as long as you and I are on this earth, as long as we live on this earth, there will always be something that we are searching for outside of ourselves, that this world doesn't have to offer. That as long as we live, we'll always be searching for something that we will never find in this world. And what I want us to know today is that those of us who are trying to live this life without Jesus, trying to live this life without Christ, we know that there is something incomplete, that there is something missing in life when you don't have Jesus. We were created to be in fellowship with Jesus, in communion with Jesus. We were created to be in constant fellowship and communion with Jesus. And really, that's kind of what seems to be going on in this passage in Matthew chapter 19. There's a young man in the text, and something was missing in his life. The special sauce of life was missing for this young man. The Bible lets us know that this young man was asking Jesus about eternal life. He wanted to know, what do I need to do to live forever? And I won't go into much of it, but that term eternal life in the Greek also means to be eternally blessed, eternally blessed. In other words, he wanted to be fulfilled. He wanted to have peace in his life and the peace of knowing Christ. He wanted to have lasting joy. You know, he wanted the special sauce of life. Well, I want to let you know three quick things about this young man in the text. And first of all, the first one is this. The first thing is, he's a young man. He's a young man. I want you to see what he has going for himself. As a young man, you would think that as a young man, he already has joy. He's young. He's got his youth. He's got his vibrancy in his life. You would think that he already has joy. As a young man, you'd think that he already would be fulfilled because he is enjoying his health and his strength and his youth. You would think that he already had contentment, that he would be at peace and that he would be happy. He's healthy. He's energetic. He's vibrant. Some commentaries say he's somewhere between the ages of 20 and 40 years old. He's young. He's in the prime of his life. This man was young, healthy, vibrant, but he was still missing something in his life. He was missing something. But not only was he young, but the Bible lets us know that he was also wealthy. And you can check this in all four accounts of the gospel. But he was wealthy. He had money. He was rolling in cash. He had the means to buy whatever it was that he wanted to buy. He dressed nice. He had the latest chariot or whatever they were riding at the time. He lived in a nicer house. But even with his wealth, y'all, even with his amount of cash, he was still looking for something that money couldn't buy. Had his youth, had money, still missing the special sauce. And you keep on reading, you'll discover that he was not only young and he was not only rich, but he was also, the Bible calls him a ruler. He had, that just basically means that he had influence, he had pull. You know, he had connections. He had the power to make things happen if he wanted to see something happen. He could make a phone call and change people's lives. He had influence. But even with all of his powerful influence and being a ruler, he was still missing something in his life. One commentary suggests that this man, young man, was also religious. Perhaps he was, you know, one of the leaders in one of the Jewish synagogues, and he served in one of those synagogues, and he was one of the leaders in that synagogue. He was maybe a leader in the community. He's young, he's rich, he's a ruler, he's religious, he's a man of faith. And even, here's where I'm going, even with all of these things going for himself, this young man still was not fulfilled, and he was searching for something that he didn't have. Didn't it sound like he would have everything he needed? He's young. He's got money. He's got influence. He's a man of faith, you know, or rather at least a ruler, you know, but perhaps a man of faith. But he was still missing something. He wasn't tapping in to that. Let me ask you something. Is that you today? Is that you? Do you have all of the needs met in your life, yet you still find that something is missing in life? Is that you? And that's what's going on with this young man. The special sauce of life was missing. And because of that, the Bible says that this young man, he had to get some answers. He had to find out what was going on. And the Bible says that this young man goes to Jesus. And he goes to Jesus and he asks Jesus. He said, I got a lot going on for myself, Jesus. You know, I got some money. I'm young. I got my health and my strength. I got a lot going for myself. And but please tell me, what is it? And watch this language that he uses, y'all. He said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What must I do? And what I want you all to notice is the fact that this man, young man, wanted to know what actions that he could do or could take for him to inherit eternal life. In other words, he wanted to earn eternal life. He wanted to find a way to earn eternal life. But how many of y'all know that we can't earn eternal life? Did you know that? Did you know that, you know, you don't have enough good deeds in you to earn eternal life? You can't walk enough old ladies across the street to earn eternal life. You cannot trick your way into salvation or even buy your way into salvation. You can't write a check big enough. You can't work your way into salvation. Salvation is a gift that can only be given to us by an almighty God. And that's why the purpose for us taking communion just a minute ago, the purpose for us partaking of the Lord's Supper is so that we can remember what Jesus did, the gift that he gave to us on the cross of Calvary. And really, if you chime in to Sunday school this morning, I hope you all do or did, depending on when you watch this, but we covered this, and we covered it last week in Sunday school. James chapter 2, verse 10 says, whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles in just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. Is guilty of it. So, you know, unless you can live a perfect life and you've never ever broken any law or any commandment, then there's no way that you can earn eternal life. And we know you can't do it because the Bible lets us know that we are born in sin and shapen in iniquity. So you cannot earn your way to salvation. You can't buy your way to salvation. In verse 20 of chapter 19, Matthew chapter 19, this young man tells Jesus, he said, well, look, Jesus, I tell you something about your law that you're talking about. I've kept the law. He said, oh yeah, I kept the law. I haven't murdered anyone. No, you can't, I'm not guilty of murder. He says, listen, I've honored my mother and my father. I've been good to my parents. So you know, I kept the law. My neighbors, oh yeah, I love my neighbors. I love my neighbors. I kept the law. But here's what this young man was missing. He was missing the spiritual nature of the commandments. And so Jesus says to him, he wanted him to get it. Jesus says, okay, young man. He says, you do this then. He said, you want to inherit eternal life? This is what you do. You go sell all of your possessions, all of the things that you have bought, and you give it to the poor. And then, after you give it to the poor, then you come and you follow me. And y'all, at this point, this young man, you know, when Jesus says that to him, this shows that this young man had gotten comfortable with his money. He had gotten comfortable, watch now, just being a good person. He had gotten comfortable during the rituals of the synagogue, just going to church every week. He had gotten comfortable, you know, and thought that was it. As long as I do this, he had gotten comfortable. And Jesus wanted him to understand, young man, you're thinking too highly of yourself. I know what you've done. I know you've honored your mother and your father. You loved your neighbors. But be careful, because you've gotten too comfortable. You're thinking too highly of yourself. And I heard somebody say this a long time ago, and it really made sense. But the Bible, or this statement that I heard, it says that Jesus came to comfort the afflicted, but he also came to afflict the comfortable. I say that one more time. That Jesus came to comfort those of us who are afflicted, and we know that he does, but he also has come to afflict those who are comfortable, who think that they've got it all together. That's what those religious leaders were doing. That's why he came. They thought they had it all together, and Jesus came to afflict them. And the truth is, y'all, a lot of us have gotten far too comfortable when it comes to our walk with God. We stopped reading our Bible, you know, we all that kind of stuff. We love God as long as it does not interrupt what's comfortable for us. And really, again, that's what our Sunday school lesson is about this morning out of the book of James. It's about coming out of your comfort zone and going far. Why? So that we can be about our Father's business. Have you gotten in a comfort zone when it comes to your faith? Well, if you have, I came to tell you, just like Jesus told this young man, you got to wake up. Don't think so highly of yourself. And I believe when we get comfortable, you know, that's when we stop being interested in ministry. And when we get too comfortable, that's when we allow somebody's opinion to get in front of our service to God. When we get too comfortable, that's when we stop reading our Bible. We stop listening to the songs of Zion and feeding our spirits and doing, you know, the good things that God has called us to do and making disciples. And, you know, when we get comfortable, you know, that's when we lose our zeal and our zest for God. And Jesus tells this young man, he said, watch what Jesus said. Jesus said, go sell all your possessions, sell it, give it to the poor, and then come and follow me. The Bible says that this young man walked away sad. He left sad. In other words, he had something in his life that he could not let go of. Why? Because he put that thing before God. He couldn't let go of it. Jesus gave him a command, you do this and follow me. He walked away sad, because he could not let go of the lifestyle that he was living. Let me ask you this, brothers and sisters. What is it that you are withholding from God? Is it your time? Are you so busy with doing this and doing life and doing this that you have no more time for God? You have no more time for intimate time with God, reading your Bible, prayer, you know, thinking on God like the Bible tells us to keep our minds stayed. Are you too busy for that? What are you withholding from God? Is it your spiritual gifts? You know you have the gift to help and be a blessing to somebody else, but you too busy. You ain't got time to be. You're not going to use the gifts that God has given you to help somebody else. Are you withholding that from God? That's the question. What are you withholding from God? Because that's what happened with this young man. This young man walked away from God because he could not walk away from the comfortable life that he was living. As I get ready to stop for today, let me close with this. I want to raise a question to you. Are you giving God what is easy for you to give to God? I want you to think about that. Are you just doing the things that are easy? As you serve God, that are easy to serve God? Or are you reaching a little bit deeper to give God the hard stuff also? Are you reaching a little bit deeper to push yourself to be more spiritual, to be more like God, to be a better disciple of Christ? When you accepted Christ, that's what you signed up for. And you know, and that's the question I want you to answer. Or is God too inconvenient, you know, is he inconveniencing you for you to do or go a little deeper? And I want to say to us as I close, this world has a whole lot to offer each one of us. I'm telling you, it has a whole lot of distractions to offer us from focusing on God. It has a whole lot of that. But if you can have Jesus in your life, brothers and sisters, and you tap into him, guess what? You have found the secret sauce to this life. You found the secret sauce. You found the sauce that money can't give you. Your love life can't give that to you. A career cannot give that to you. Only Jesus can provide the fulfillment that you and I need in this life. Some people only want to give God a small area of their life. They only want to give him a small piece. But y'all, if you accept Jesus in your heart, guess what? He wants all of you. He wants all of you. I pray that you receive this today, and I pray that you have been helped and encouraged and challenged to go a little deeper. That don't get comfortable in your faith. Don't get so comfortable that now you on cruise control for God. No, God told this young man, as he, you know, honoring his mother and father, he's doing some good things. But God said, listen, you got to go a little bit further. You got to dig a little bit deeper. This young man couldn't do that. Let me ask, can you do it? Can you dig a little bit deeper for the kingdom of God? I pray that you will at least give it a try. Let me pray for you. Lord, we give you thanks and we give you praise for this yet another blessed Sunday. I pray, Heavenly Father, that we have been challenged and encouraged by this few minutes that we have spent together. I pray for each person under the sound of my voice that you would not only meet each one of us at our point of need, but even more so, Lord, that we would be challenged, Lord, in our own life to forgive more, to love more, to dig deeper. Why? Because, Lord, you gave us your all, and we should give it. We should in turn give you our all. We thank you in advance. In Jesus' name, amen. There's some information below. If you want to accept Jesus as your personal Savior, invite you to contact me, and I'll walk you through the scriptures to help you to be saved. Thank you for joining us today. God bless you. Have a great day.
Come on, let the sound of worship be released from your lips tonight. Come on, raise it now. Y'all raising the motion. You gotta take, so you provide the spirit,
you provide the spirit.